As actors, we get to rely on scripts to tell us what to do.
Like when to slap someone across the face and when to let someone slap you.
But we don't need a script to tell us to help someone in need.
The SAG Foundation was founded to do just that, to help performers with life's unscripted moments and to give back to our communities.
Over the past decade, the SAG Foundation has given millions in financial and medical assistance to SAG-AFTRA performers and their families.
Last year, more than 25,000 union performers attended over 500 SAG Foundation Q&As, seminars, and workshops.
And SAG Foundation Book Pals read to over 60,000 children in schools every month nationwide.
Do you know how much SAG-AFTRA members pay for all these resources and programs? Zero.
Zero.
Zilch.
Nada.
Do you know how much of our union dues go to the SAG Foundation? Zero.
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 The SAG Foundation is a nonprofit that relies solely on donations, so it is vital that those who are able to help give what they can.
And you've been giving since the SAG Foundation was founded in 1985.
I love 1985.
Out of Africa.
The Color Purple. The Goonies.
The Cosby Show.
Family Ties.
The Golden Girls.
What?
So many truly fantastic performances since then.
We have a wonderful history and a beautiful tradition of being there for one another.
If you need help, it's here for you.
And if you can help, please give.
Like every great production, we are at our best when we all act
together.
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 So please, act now.
To all our guests here in the offices in New York, those in LA, and all of everybody who's joining us through your various windows onto the internet, welcome to the LGBT and Entertainment Sexual Orientation and Gender Identity Town Hall. My name is Adam Moore. I'm the National Director of EEO and Diversity here at SAG-AFTRA. I'll be serving as this evening's MC and co-moderator. We'll have Gary Riotto serving as our other co-moderator from Los Angeles. Gary is a member of the SAG-AFTRA LGBT Committee and is an actor, director, and writer who splits his time between LA and New York. Tonight, we've specifically enlisted him for his special skill set of facilitating and keeping everybody under control, because the LA room gets pretty raucous. So Gary, make sure you keep folks under control out there. We'll have some additional ground rules and things to go through, but for now, I'd just like to thank everybody for coming out tonight. It's late in New York. Depending on where you are around the world, we have some people who are joining us via LA, New York, Massachusetts. And I know that it's tough to come out for these sorts of things, but we have an amazing new tool at our disposal that we plan to use to improve the professional lives of our LGBT brothers and sisters. And it's important that you guys are all here tonight. In order to give you some perspective on why we're all here, it's my great privilege to introduce a champion of equal rights for all members, and someone who has supported this particular initiative since the beginning. He's the first elected president of SAG-AFTRA, having previously served as SAG-AFTRA's co-president after the historic merger in March of 2012. He previously served two terms as Screen Actors Guild president, and as an actor's actor, he's earned a formidable list of credits and several awards, including his second Emmy in 2009 for his role in HBO's critically acclaimed series Grey Garden. He also recently appeared as U.S. Attorney General Harlan F. Stone in the motion picture J. Edgar, and the recurring role as Hank Hooper in NBC's 30 Rock. He'll next be seen in the motion picture The Judge, premiering in 2014, and is shooting the Wedding Ringer. He's a Tony-winning actor, has appeared in more than 20 feature films, started numerous series, miniseries, and movies. In addition to making countless guest appearances, he helped create The White Shadow, which some of us in the room hopefully remember. It's a groundbreaking television series in which he starred from 78 to 82. This published author is not just our union president, but he's also portrayed a handful of U.S. presidents over his career, so he's likely used to being introduced this way. Please welcome, from the SAG Foundation Actors Center in Los Angeles, Mr. President Ken Howell.
Hi, everybody. Thanks, Adam. Is it working? Okay, great. I'll stay on copy pretty much, but before I start just officially, But before I start just officially, you'd think I'd be used to this by now. I think this is thrilling. This is great. This is the beginning, in a sense, of a lot of things that we're going to be working on. And this gets a little official. But I'm happy to be included in all this. And part of why I'm saying that to you is that I very much cared about these issues, and perhaps among other reasons, because I started in musical comedy. Need I say more? So I'm really pleased to be here. Tonight is a big night. We're going to be discussing a groundbreaking study that explores SAG-AFTRA's members' attitudes and beliefs about sexual orientation and gender identity in entertainment. 8 years ago, comedian Jason Stuart asked the Screen Actors Guild board to consider forming an LGBT committee, and the time was right. What had been fear of stereotyping and blacklisting had become the certain knowledge that change was needed, and after consulting with members, we created the first SAG National LGBT Committee. LGBT members and allies alike responded with a resounding yes. In its early days, the committee heard a number of things about the need to educate SAG-AFTRA members, the industry, and the public to help end discrimination in the workplace so that LGBT actors could pursue their careers without fear of being out. The committee wanted to know what pressures cause actors and other performers to fear for their jobs, and how to even begin to affect change in this complex industry. We wanted to move beyond anecdote to action. To understand what was really going on in audition rooms, in meetings with agents and managers, on set, and behind the scenes where casting decisions are made. To find that out, we turned to the prestigious Williams Institute at UCLA School of Law to design an attitude and opinion study. We turned to our partners at the SAG Producers Industry Advancement Cooperative Fund for funding. And we turned to you, our members, to tell us straight up what you think. And nearly 6,000 of you, LGBT and non-LGBT alike, responded by taking the survey. Today's SAG-AFTRA, our National LGBT Committee and co-chairs, Jason Stuart and Traci Godfrey, stand with our LGBT brothers and sisters to continue improving the workplace. And so does our membership. The delegates to the SAG-AFTRA 2013 convention unanimously approved a resolution to endorse the LGBT committee's work and approved a plan to fully utilize the results of this landmark study. These next steps are crucial because it tells us how we can best put the results of our work into practice. There is much more to come this evening, and I invite you all to listen and be prepared to discuss our results and our thoughts on next steps. Working together, we can improve the lives of our members and all industry professionals who refuse to be limited by those who would define them as only lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender. We are honored to support this study and the initiative and are committed to achieving a level playing field for all workers in our industries. That's all pretty dry, but it does come from the heart with a lot of us and is genuinely felt, and the commitment is real. Again, thank you all for being with us today, and let me now introduce our speaker, who I really enjoyed chatting with, and he's a terrific guy, and I've admired him for quite some time and didn't realize that my stepdaughter had gone to college with him, but I know now. Best known for his 2013 Emmy Award-winning portrayal of James Novak in ABC's Scandal, Dan Bucatinsky is a talented multi-hyphenate. He writes, produces, and stars in two cable hits, HBO's The Comeback, which he created with longtime producing partner Lisa Kudrow, and Showtime's Web Therapy, which he created with longtime husband, director Don Roos. He and Lisa Kudrow have also been recently Emmy nominated for their docuseries, Who Do You Think You Are on TLC. Let me do that again. He and Lisa Kudrow have also been recently Emmy nominated for their docuseries, Who Do You Think You Are on TLC. You've seen Dan in roles on Grey's Anatomy In Plain Sight, Curb Your Enthusiasm, Will and Grace, Weeds, and such films as All Over the Guy, Under the Tuscan Sun, Bounce, and The Opposite of Sex. His two children, Eliza and Jonah, inspired him to write his autobiographical tales of parenting in the best-selling book, Does This Baby Make Me Look Straight? I love that title. This fall, you'll see Dan on NBC's new series, Marry Me. Now, here's the test, and I'll tell you why. Dan is an advocate for LGBT rights, and his portrayal and creation of characters, both LGBT and non-LGBT, in film, television, and new media truly make him someone who is breaking the mold for LGBT talent in entertainment. That's four times in one sentence. Let's all say it together. LGBT. LGBT. Practice that. Please join me in welcoming the remarkable Dan Bucatinsky.
Thank you. LGBTQ, right? There's always another one. Well, thank you for having me. I'm going to juggle my water and my mic and my paper, from which I will read, because I have a lot to talk about on this topic, which I feel very passionately about. And I feel very honored to have been asked. So know that. And just hold on one second. Dry mouth. Okay. Oh, look at this. There's a shelf. So coming out of the closet is a bitch. And awesome. And awful. And well, okay, for some it's harder than others, depending on where we're from and how we were brought up. For those of us who've been twirling in tutus to the soundtrack of Fame since age three, the news hits with a much lower, let's say, gasp factor than for others. Regardless, the tiny three-word phrase, I am gay, feels almost nuclear in its power. It indelibly marks that particular before and after in a very specific, life-defining way. It takes courage, self-acceptance, and resolve. It changes us forever, whether the act comes out of rebellion, confession, or liberation. Once you're out, you can't really creep back in, unless, you know, maybe you're in show business. About 1 month after I'd met my current husband, Don, in 1992, he invited me to be his date at the premiere of his first film, Love Field, starring Michelle Pfeiffer. I remember feeling a wave of excitement at the opportunity to be Don's plus one. They were having a screening and after party in Westwood, but he told me soon after we wouldn't be staying for the screening. Don and the film's producers, along with Michelle and her, at the time, new husband, David Kelly, would all be going to dinner together instead. My jaw dropped. What? I was going to be sitting at an intimate dinner table with Michelle Pfeiffer. My heart should have skipped a beat, but instead it sank. What's the matter? Don asked, already adept at reading my pathetic attempts to hide my emotions. At 27, I had moved to Los Angeles only a year earlier to pursue my career as an actor and a writer. But I was still very much in the closet, professionally speaking, of course. It was 1992. There was no Will and Grace yet, and it was easily 4 years before Ellen kissed Laura Dern on that groundbreaking episode of her television show. It was more than a decade before the mad dash out closet doors of trailblazers like Elton John, Rosie O'Donnell, Neil Patrick Harris. Now such events barely make headlines. Whoever imagined we would live to see America take a casual, almost who the hell cares approach to this kind of news? But this was a different time, and I was different. I was an aspiring actor. Can't even say it anymore. Before I knew, the word aspiring at the time was synonymous with desperate and hungry and unemployed. I had come out to my family merely 2 years earlier. The notion of being out in public, even before anyone, even the public, knew or cared who I was, unfathomable. So I say to Don, what if I'm in a movie one day with Michelle Pfeiffer? Don laughed. What? It could happen. I was adamant. Yes, he finally conceded, of course it could happen. But you think she hasn't come face to face with a homo before? He laughed again. Of course he was right, but I'll say it again. I was only 27. Do I go to the dinner and support my new boyfriend and meet an iconic movie star and possibly risk whatever professional fallout comes from being an actor who is outed? Well, I did go with Don to the dinner with Pfeiffer. She was lovely. Probably the most radiantly beautiful woman I'd ever seen up close and personal, so to speak. Michelle sat next to her husband, who sat next to someone I don't remember, who sat next to their publicist, who sat next to someone else I don't remember. Michelle didn't know the names of everyone at that table either. And she certainly didn't register my name or that I was even there, let alone whose boyfriend I was or wasn't. She was polite, of course, but we were not friends, and she must have met hundreds of people that night. I was not the first and foremost on her mind. Phew, I thought. I could probably still work with her, and she'll never remember. It was important to me still that I feel like nobody knew. It took me several years before I felt comfortable having people in the industry know that I was gay. In 2001, even, when my film All Over the Guy was released, it was the first time I had to deal with marketing campaigns and publicists and press junkets. At long last, I had managed to wedge my way front and center. And while the film came from a place of truth, I still fought it. I had convinced myself it wasn't a gay film, but a romantic comedy that just happened to have two gays as its protagonists. Isn't that the definition of a gay film? I convinced myself we would cross over to a straight audience as long as I didn't push some kind of gay agenda. Oh, how little I understood about the audience's appetite for man-on-man action. In hindsight, I realized what I wanted really was for people to believe I can play any role, not just gay. And I was willing to closet myself once again in the press in order to achieve my unrealistic goal. Luckily, though, my closet was a glass one. Your work speaks louder than your agenda. I had written a role for myself as a gay man looking for love and honesty and intimacy. And by exposing the simple truths about characters who just happened to be gay, I too was exposing myself. It scared me. I wasn't ready for it. But sometimes you need to be pushed off the diving board before you can show the world that you know how to swim. What had I been fighting so hard for in the end? The way to reach my most authentic self on screen in my writing and in my personal life was to be honest. It's 20 years later, my soul-bearing stories of being a gay dad published, released, Does This Baby Make Me Look Straight? Yes, it's a fairly ironic title given my earlier desires to pass as straight, but now nothing is farther from my mind, and certainly from the minds of those who know me and are gifted with sight and hearing. Furthermore, I got to play the character of James Novak on the Shonda Rhimes ABC series Scandal. It was a complex role that challenged me as an actor in ways I never thought possible. And yes, it led to the most surprising turn of events in my career in Emmy. But make no mistakes, it was a role I got because I was gay. Would I have gotten it had I not been out? No way to know, but probably not. This was my journey, for me. Coming out was essential to my growth as a person and as an actor. I am a gay man, which means I am gay, yes, but I'm also a man. And as a man, there are some things I can't do. I'm not talking about peeing sitting down because I can do that, and I do from time to time. But seriously, I don't feel like the limitations of being a man should be looked at as an injustice for which I need to be protected nor compensated. They are realities based on who I am, and at times I'll benefit from who I am, and other times suffer from it, for it. I know women feel even more so, that their gender feels at times like a disadvantage, and other times quite the blessing. Now, while I think we can all stipulate that there should be zero tolerance for the mistreatment of someone based on their sex or gender, religion, sexual orientation, let's talk about the word discrimination. We are in a business where the very creative process is an act of discriminating. A painter chooses purple rather than yellow. He visualizes those first few brushstrokes on that canvas and maybe sees purple. Is he discriminating against yellow? In that moment, sure. Likewise, a writer comes up with a script and visualizes those characters. They are, hopefully, specific and real and complicated. So casting based on that script is an act of discriminating, distinguishing in our minds who that character is and how they may look or sound or behave. The job of casting is a job of distinguishing, discerning, yes, discriminating talent, one from the other. I can't play a woman. I can play a man dressed as a woman, but nobody wants to see that. It's not pretty. It's not my forte. If someone writes a script with a female African-American lead, would I deserve the right to be considered for it? I know, race and gender, very visible traits, so it's much harder to pass as a black woman when I am, in fact, a white man. But as a gay man, the fact of my sexuality, my orientation with which I believe I was born, can in many cases be hidden from the discriminating eye, but not always. I believe our job as actors, as much as possible, is to be a blank slate, a chameleon who can become, if cast, someone else. Our ability to get inside a character first created in the mind of a writer is what we train to do. That's our craft. Our goal is to be as authentic and honest in those roles as we are innately able to do, or trained to do. But therein lies the irony. I spent years in the closet, afraid that the fact of my sexuality would hinder me from getting roles in television shows and films. And as a result, I worked very hard to act like an actor who wasn't who I was. My first role for which I cast myself was that of a straight actor. I walked into every casting session with a mask already on. And from there, I would add a second mask, that of the character for which I was reading. Needless to say, I didn't get a lot of work. But to the gay actor who has made his living as a heterosexual sex symbol, or to any actor who continues to remain a mystery to the public and are able to reap the rewards of employment as a result, I say, stay in the closet if that is working for you authentically. Nobody can tell anyone else who they must be or to whom. And there are varying degrees of out. Not everyone needs to live their lives like an open book. That's a matter of personal choice. But if anyone had told me back in 1992 that one day I'd be married to a man and have two kids and also play some guy's TV husband on a show that launched around the time the first black president of the United States spoke out in favor of marriage equality, I would have sworn pigs were flying. While I don't think it's anyone's business in our business who we sleep with, who we vote for, what our religious beliefs are, or political affiliations, or our actual age, God help me, IMDb. Those facts about ourselves help define us. And in stripping away the layers of masks that hide our true selves, we become more honest, more open, more authentic. And I would say, I would dare say, better actors. So there's the rub. What we do need to do is fight to make sure actors live in an environment where we can feel free to be who we are, if we so choose. In some cases, it may make people have a harder time imagining them in roles for which we feel we may be right. When I see an actor I know is straight in a love scene with a man, I don't know about you, but I can't help wonder, is that the first guy he's kissed? Is he comfortable? Does his wife mind? Does he secretly love it? It's distracting. As distracting as it may be to see a gay actor, an actor you know is gay, playing a straight role, and knowing, wow, I wonder if that's hard for them. I play mostly gay roles, and I know for a fact that it's harder for people to imagine me as a straight man because they know I am gay. Is this something I need to fight? Is it their fault that they imagine me with a penis in my mouth when I'm reading for straight roles? I can't help what they think. Being out to myself and the world limited the ways in which people can see me, yes. But it also made me a better actor. And it afforded me opportunities I know I would never have had if I'd stayed in the closet. So, here we are. It's 2014. And I'm gay and out, and pigs are flying. Now, can someone get me an address for Michelle Pfeiffer? Because I want to send her my book. Thank you very, very much.
So funny. He said the word penis, so there is no topping that. That's the first thing I thought of when I heard it. I'm Gary Riotto. Adam introduced me from New York, and from here moving forward, I'm going to co-moderate the second half of this evening. But the first thing I'd like to do is thank Dan and President Howard. Let's give them another round of applause. as an out gay actor and member of the LGBT committee, I want to thank Dan for all the work that he does, both behind the camera and in front of the camera, because it's contributions like yours, Dan, that help pave the way for our LGBT performing community, and we are all very, very grateful. I saw all of you nodding and smiling, so I just wanted to thank you. So we've come here together today so we can share this first of its kind study with you. You've heard it said about 5-6 times already, right? So we're about to move into that section where we share the actual study with you. The purpose of tonight is twofold. We want to make sure that you understand what the study means, what it contains, and also what it means to you. So there are going to be three parts to the remainder of the evening moving forward. We're going to share the study, then we're going to hear from a panel of our colleagues about their personal experiences, and then we're going to share with you our intended next steps in relation to what we can do with the study to strengthen our community. So what we would like to do is we'd like to hear from you in all three of those areas. So please ask any questions that you have about the study. You can feel free to share any anecdotes about your personal experiences and any thoughts or suggestions you have in relation to how we can best use the study moving forward. So there are a few ways you can do that. In the room here in LA and in New York City, we're gonna do it old school. You're gonna write on a note card and you're gonna pass it up to the front of the room. If you are watching at home, you have two options: Twitter, hashtag SAGF, S-A-G-F, or you can email at livestream@sagfoundation.org. Just please know too that your questions or your story will be relayed anonymously, so you should feel free to be candid. We've purposely set it up that way. You're not seen on camera, no names will be given, so please, comments in all three of those areas are really encouraged. So, with all of that technical stuff out of the way, I would like to introduce our phenomenal partners in this endeavor, Lee Badgett and Jody Herman from the Williams Institute at UCLA Law School. Lee Badgett is a Williams Institute Distinguished Scholar and Director of the Center for Public Policy and Administration and Professor of Economics at the University of Massachusetts, Amherst, where she is joining us from her office. Hi, Lee. Are you with us?
Hi, Gary. Good evening.
Is everybody here? Great. Hello. And Jody L. Herman is here with us in LA. She is a Peter J. Cooper Public Policy Fellow and manager of transgender research at the Williams Institute, UCLA School of Law, and she is joining us here. One quick reminder, if you have a question about the study, do us a favor and note, there's gonna be a PowerPoint presentation. So put the number of the slide on your question so that if either of them need to refer back to it, they can, okay? So start thinking about questions as you start hearing information. Jody?
Use a fancy gadget. Screen. Okay. Thank you, Gary. And Lee and I are very excited to have worked with SAG-AFTRA on this study and are very happy to be here to share the findings with you. We'd like to thank SAG-AFTRA and the IACF for making this research possible and for your commitment to issues of diversity, including issues that impact LGBT performers. So first, a little bit about the Williams Institute. We are a research center in the UCLA School of Law, and we focus on research about sexual orientation and gender identity law and policy issues. The Institute, and Lee in particular, has conducted many studies regarding employment, discrimination, and fairness and diversity issues in the workplace. The entertainment industry is very significant, not only as an employer, and particularly as an employer of LGBT people, but also in how many people the industry reaches through film, television, and other media. So we were thrilled to partner with SAG-AFTRA to study the employment experiences of LGBT performers in this industry. There we go. So the central research question for this study is as follows. How do the experiences of LGBT performers compare to non-LGBT performers? When we started looking into this question, we often heard that the entertainment industry is a creative industry, that it's very supportive of LGBT people, and that many LGBT people work in the industry. I think that was only three times wrong. So it's a very friendly place for LGBT people to work. But at the same time, we also heard anecdotal reports of experiencing discrimination in employment and other problems faced by LGBT performers. So Lee and I, coming from outside the industry, believe it or not, we're not actors, we convened focus groups with LGBT performers, and they were able to help us understand these issues better by sharing their experiences with us. And they helped us formulate a survey that would allow us to study this issue and better understand what, if any, barriers LGBT people are experiencing in employment in the entertainment industry. So based on what we learned through those focus groups, we formulated a survey that would allow us to study this issue and compare the experiences of LGBT performers and non-LGBT performers. The survey was offered online to SAG-AFTRA members and was fielded in the fall of 2012. We received nearly 5,700 completed responses, and 15% of those responses were from LGBT members. In terms of demographics, the age, sex, and state of residence of the survey sample were very similar with the full SAG-AFTRA membership. So in that way, the sample was representative. Race and ethnicity of the survey sample was generally similar to the U.S. population, but white respondents were slightly overrepresented in the sample, and Latinos and Latinas were slightly underrepresented in the sample. So out of the 5,700 respondents, we had over 800 lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender respondents. But unfortunately, we only had 7 transgender respondents. And this means that we were not able to do much analysis with these respondents because of the small sample size. That's something, of course, that we would like to continue to study in the future. But we did have several survey questions that speak to perceptions of and experiences of transgender performers, and those findings are outlined more thoroughly in the report. So out of the 5,700 survey respondents, 15% of all men identified as gay, and 5% of all men identified as bisexual, and 2% of all women identified as lesbian, and 5% of all women identified as bisexual. Compared to non-LGBT respondents, LGBT respondents were more likely to be male, younger, less likely to have children, less likely to be married or partnered, but they were similar in on other demographic factors, including race. So one of the first things we wanted to get an idea of is what the SAG-AFTRA membership environment was like for LGBT performers or LGBT members. So in general, SAG-AFTRA provides a supportive union environment with members holding very supportive views about LGBT people. The survey assessed respondents' comfort level with people who are gay or lesbian and with people who are transgender. SAG-AFTRA members reported being comfortable around and comfortable working with lesbian, gay, and transgender people at high rates, represented by the blue and red segments on the chart over there. We chose questions like these because they're similar to questions that are asked of the general U.S. population in other surveys, which allows us to compare. And so we find that SAG-AFTRA members seem much more comfortable and supportive of LGBT rights than the U.S. population based on these and other survey questions that we asked. Respondents were also generally supportive of LGBT people playing heterosexual and non-transgender roles. For example, 80% of respondents agreed that transgender women should be considered for roles written for women, and that transgender men should be considered for roles written for men. However, we did find that LGBT performers may have substantial barriers to overcome in their search for jobs and while on the job in this industry. And so to describe our findings about those barriers, I'm going to turn it over to Lee Badgett.
Thank you, Jody, and thank you all for having us here tonight. As she mentioned, I get to be the bearer of the bad news, and I'm going to talk about the evidence that LGBT performers actually do face some barriers and challenges that aren't there for non-LGBT people. And if you took the survey, you know that we asked a lot of questions about people's experiences, whether they were before they got into the entertainment industry, their experiences getting jobs and how they're treated on the job. And we can't really go through all of that tonight, so I'm going to hit some highlights. And I'll say also we made some comparisons of key measures of how well people are doing professionally, like how much they earn from acting, to see if there are differences by sexual orientation. So there's a lot of data, and I'm going to just start by going right to the heart of the matter. Jody has already gone to the next slide. To look at whether or not people have had the experience in the industry that suggests that decision makers are biased or not. So we asked whether casting directors recommend the best actor regardless of sexual orientation or gender identity. Do producers and directors hire the best actor regardless of being LGBT or not? And what we found is that a fair number of people, particularly LGBT people, and the blue bars on the screen, suggest that they do think that sexual orientation and gender identity play a role in being hired, being recommended. Non-LGBT people see less of that sort of bias. 29% see it for casting directors and 34% for producers and directors. So going to the next slide, we can get a sense of why this might matter. And Dan was speaking to this issue. We heard this in focus groups. The idea that sexual orientation might matter to decision makers because audiences aren't really ready to accept LGBT performers in certain kinds of roles. Our respondents to the survey, though, didn't buy into this. More than two-thirds said that they believe that LGBT actors are marketable to the public, that the public will be willing to see films and TV shows with LGBT actors in heterosexually romantic roles. But the respondents to the survey do think that studio executives and producers buy into this idea that LGBT people are less marketable. 85% of the lesbian and gay respondents agreed, and 62% of non-LGBT respondents agreed that there is this belief among studio execs and producers. Next slide, please. So if marketability is an issue for playing heterosexual roles, what about LGBT roles? We heard very mixed opinions about this in the focus groups as to whether or not these roles are opportunities or whether or not they are barriers. Interestingly, we found that a vast majority, more than two-thirds of gay and lesbian actors who responded, have played LGBT roles at some point in the past. Those are the pink bars on the screen. The purple bars in the middle, those two sections for men and women, are the bisexual performers who responded. They were less likely to have played LGBT roles. And the heterosexual respondents were the least likely. 39% of straight men had played an LGBT role and about a third of heterosexual women. Actually, some people find that surprisingly large as a percentage. But it suggests that it's much more common for LGBT people. Now, one issue is whether or not people will be typecast as a result. And people were worried that they would be perceived as LGBT just because of having played a role like that. But that was only about a third of respondents who were concerned about that. A pretty small proportion, about 25% of the lesbian and gay respondents and about 25% of the bisexual respondents thought that it had, in fact, affected whether they were hired for straight roles later on. So to some extent, at least some people did experience something of the typecasting that people do fear. So what happens on the job? As we go to the next slide, I'm going to start talking a little bit about the evidence that bias does, in fact, sometimes enter the job setting and affect the conditions that LGBT performers work in. More than half of the performers had heard any gay comments, anti-LGBT comments on the set. And more than a quarter of the actors who responded have seen LGBT actors treated with less respect on set. So that is evidence that bias sometimes happens. There's actually, these are the more traditional kinds of anti-gay comments that are very clear and obvious. On the next slide, we see that in addition to those obvious kinds of comments, there are more subtle comments that also bothered some of the actors who we talked to in the focus groups and who responded. 21% of the lesbian and gay respondents and a fair number, 11% of bisexual respondents, had casting directors make comments to them that made them uncomfortable. when they were asked to butch it up in an audition, for example, or were told that when they were auditioning for a gay role that they should be a little more obviously gay, which made people feel very uncomfortable and feel like they were being subjected to stereotypes. The next slide looks more directly at the kinds of impacts that actually directly harm the LGBT actors who responded to this survey. 20% of gay men, 13% of lesbians, 10% of bisexual men, and 6% of bisexual women had actually reported some kind of experience of discrimination and harassment on the job at some point in their careers, and often had experienced this in different kinds of ways and more than once. But these are figures that are actually pretty comparable to what we see nationally for LGBT people when they report discrimination in the workplace. Now, here's the interesting thing. The next slide shows it's not just in the heads of LGBT people. We also ask these questions to heterosexual people, but we ask them if they had witnessed this sort of discrimination. And in fact, they have. 13% of the non-LGBT respondents had seen some kind of discrimination against LGBT performers. More than a quarter of them had heard anti-gay comments on set by new members, producers, and directors. And 10% had seen, at some point in their careers, LGBT actors treated with less courtesy and respect. And in many cases, they actually wrote down stories of those experiences in the workplace. So we see this evidence of troubling behavior, of challenges and barriers that are faced by LGBT performers. So the last question that we asked has to do with different kinds of employment outcomes that might have been affected. We saw that LGBT performers got similar types of roles and jobs, so they don't look very different in terms of having lead roles versus supporting roles or versus background roles. They end up just as often in film and TV and commercials as heterosexual people do. But we saw some evidence in earnings to suggest that there are differences in opportunities and differences in treatment, perhaps, in terms of the terms and conditions of employment. So bisexual men's earnings from acting were lower than heterosexual men's in the measures that we had. We saw that lesbian and gay actors had lower average daily earnings than heterosexual actors. And these are the results of some fancy statistical analyses that we did, where we took into account lots of other things that might also affect these outcomes. But we still saw in these three examples that sexual orientation was a factor that caused LGBT actors' earnings to be lower. A second very important workplace outcome, which Dan has spoken to very eloquently, has to do with the impact on people's ability to come out at work. We asked a whole bunch of different questions about coming out in different kinds of ways. Across the board, it was very interesting. We found that lesbian and gay performers were much more likely to be out professionally than were bisexual actors. The chart you see on the screen there shows you that bisexual men and women are very unlikely to be out. In fact, this is because more than half of bisexual women and two-thirds of bisexual men say they are not out in professional life, whereas only 21% of lesbians and 27% of gay men think of themselves as being pretty much closeted in the professional sense. So is it surprising in the context of the kind of evidence of barriers and challenges? Maybe not. But it was interesting because amongst those who were out, the lesbian and gay respondents, 72% said that it didn't have a harmful effect on their career. And in fact, many of those people said they would encourage other LGBT performers to come out. Of course, one reason they're not out is fear of discrimination. But there are lots of reasons why people said that it's good to be out, and Dan spoke to some of these. Better for your mental health. You have more control over how you're viewed if you decide to come out yourself. Many people said they thought that it improved their quality of work and people could be themselves in an audition. But this last slide that Jody's put up here shows just how complicated this is. We asked about how out people were to people in different categories within the industry. And we've arranged these so you can see how clearly the pattern, the decisions that people make about being out depend on who they're interacting with. So as you go up the industry hierarchy, people are less and less out. the taller blue bars are the lesbian and gay respondents, and then the shorter red ones are bisexual respondents. About half of lesbian and gay actors, 53%, are out to other actors. 36% are out to agents, and then we see a really sharp drop off when you get the directors and casting directors and crew members and public and producers. We're dropping down around to the 20% range. When we get to the media and industry executives, we're in the teens, 14% for the media and 13% of industry executives. So these are the percentages of lesbian, gay, and bisexual people who are out to all or most of the people in those categories. So this was a very striking finding from the survey that suggests that people really are not very comfortable and are concerned about how they will be perceived in the industry. So our takeaway points in the last slide, kind of come back to the point that Jody started with. We saw that the vast majority of SAG-AFTRA members are comfortable with and supportive of LGBT people. We also asked about improvements over time, and regardless of sexual orientation and gender identity, actors have seen improvements in opportunities for LGBT actors. But on the other hand, we are still seeing these challenges remaining. There are different earnings outcomes, there are reports of discrimination, there are reports of harassment and of anti-gay comments, other workplace issues that are visible not just to LGBT actors, but to heterosexual actors as well. So while there's a good news side, there's also this other side of the equation that suggests there is still work to do. So I think at this point, we're going to hand it back over to Adam, who I think Jody and I just want to acknowledge as having been a wonderful person to work with in the course of this project, and he made it all much better. So thank you, Adam.
Well, that's very kind of you, Lee. I'll take that. It's been quite a journey to get here. Adam Moore here in New York again. While there's a lot to get through. People in the rooms in LA and New York, you have the full study itself that you can refer to later. This shiny new thing is in both coasts. It'll be to your local soon. The online version is at www.sagaftra.org/EEO and diversity if you want to find it. As we're getting questions and things via Twitter and people in the rooms, let me just give you a sense of some of the things that we're hearing in the room and in social media based on what you had said and what the study results bear out. Is this idea that one of the slides, I think it was slide 10 that you had mentioned, concerning people who were asked to maybe play against who it is that they are. I think one of the quotes was, to butch it up or to be more gay, less gay in your affectation. Were there any study results that spoke to this idea? I know there was a section about gender nonconformity. So was there anything along those lines that you could speak to about how people felt that they were treated if they perhaps expressed a gender that they themselves were not, or were given directions that were perhaps against their type? And we'll then open it up to the panelists from there to talk a bit more about whether or not they think that that is just part of the deal of being an actor and what you're asked to do and being given direction and having to respond to it. So I'll first ask the researchers if there was anything that came through the study when it comes to gender nonconformity in that way, and then have our panelists think about what that actually looks like in real life, because we're going to talk about what your rights are, we're going to talk about what the responses were, but there's also the realities that you all face when you're in the audition room and you're on set being asked things in the room. We'll try to look at some of those realities as well. So Lee or Jody?
Yeah, I'll just start and then I'll ask Lee to jump in. There is a section in the report, if I believe we have copies available, that does deal specifically with the topic of gender nonconformity. We, in the survey, were able to ask people whether they, it's a two-part question about the way you appear and your mannerisms and whether or not you find yourself on a masculine or feminine spectrum in those two areas. And we did have some significant results based on gender nonconformity, that people who are gender nonconforming might not be faring as well in the industry as those who are gender conforming. And so that is something actually that we want to study further and go deeper into the data set about that particular issue, because it did stand out to both Lee and I. Lee, did you have anything to add?
I was going to add that the gender nonconformity response really made a big difference in terms of how people seem to come out in some cases. We asked people if they thought that other people could tell that they were gay. And people who reported to us that they were perceived as being somewhat gender nonconforming were more likely to think that people thought that they were lesbian and gay or bisexual. And so it's kind of a complicated potential link. But I think the idea that it's connected to being out and being out and is connected to being, potentially more vulnerable to discrimination, and the fact that we did see a little bit of evidence of adverse outcomes suggests that gender nonconformity is an important thing to be thinking about.
And you gave the breakdown in terms of who responded and who didn't, but there have been a couple comments about only 7 transgender respondents. Mm-hmm. What do we think about that? What does that have to? How does that impact the results that we have? Is that something that we need to look into more? What did you feel was maybe missing from the report? That no promises here, but future efforts and research might entail, given the few number of people who actually responded from that community.
I'll start and then I'll ask Lee if she has anything to add. It's true, we only had 7 trans respondents out of about 5,700 surveys, which is incredibly low. The way that the survey was administered, it was an online survey and it was submitted through the SAG-AFTRA membership listserv. So it could speak to a couple of things. It could speak to the fact that just the trans community is incredibly small. Only about 0.3% of the US general population self-identifies as transgender, which is about 700,000 people in the United States. So it's a small community to begin with. But second of all, it could say something about the connectedness of trans people to the union, which is something that I think might deserve a little bit more explanation. But we, luckily, we approached the survey asking about LGBT people without necessarily needing the responses from LGBT people. So we asked a lot of attitude questions about how people perceive LGBT people are treated. So we do have some things to say about the transgender sample, but I do think it begs for more research and probably using a little bit of a different methodology in order to gain access to that small community of trans performers. Lee, did you have anything to add?
No, I think you covered it.
Okay, great.
Okay, I'll turn it over to...
time that ever happened.
I'm going to turn it over to Gary for any questions that are coming out of Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Gary?
Hi, Adam. We have a bunch of them, actually, and one that we've gotten multiple times is you shared that out of 834 LGBT SAG-AFTRA members responded, mm-hmm. out of a total of nearly 6,000. So mm-hmm. that's about 15%, I think I saw on the slide, right?
That's correct. Mm-hmm.
So the question is, looking at those numbers, it seems like only a small portion of survey responders were LGBT. How do we know that that truly reflects their opinions? And we've gotten that a few times.
Okay. Again, I'll start. Lee, unless you really have something to say right off the bat.
Okay.
Well, 15% might not seem like much, but in out in the U.S. general population, that's huge. 15% is huge. In the U.S. general population, only about 3.5% of people identify as LGB, and only 0.3% identify as transgender. And so to have a 15% rate of LGBT respondents in the samples. Actually, it doesn't seem like much, but it's actually huge. And the way that the survey was deployed, it did go out to the full population. So oftentimes you don't get to study an entire population. You have to take a sample from a larger population, like the polling samples that we're all really familiar with. But in this case, we sent the survey out to the entire membership, which was our population of interest. And so we do believe that those 800 respondents are likely representative of what people who would be reached through that online methodology what their experiences were. But Lee might disagree. I think that might be a point of contention, but who knows?
Yeah, it's hard to know. That's a good question. I'll tell you something interesting, though, which is that it's different for men and for women. And I don't remember the exact figures, but it's actually about 20% of the men who answered the survey identified as gay or bisexual, and it was only about 5% of the women. So that raises an interesting question, you know, given the usual national population figures that Jody mentioned. So it's possible that if we were going to get, you know, an unusual group of people who were heavily, you know, much more heavily LGBT than normal, then we would have expected the men and women to be about the same percentage. Mm-hmm. But I think the fact that we're seeing women are about the national percentage, but the men are way above it, you know, might actually suggest that gay and bisexual men are just more likely to be actors. And you've never heard that before, I'm sure.
We have statistical proof.
So funny. The next question I had is from slide number 13. And this person actually is asking about clarity in relation to the average daily rate for LGBT actors being less than heterosexual actors. They're wondering if it was wages per year, was it less due to fewer work days or less due to work opportunities? Mm-hmm. It's a great question.
Yeah, it is a good question. We didn't really find a big difference in the explicit measure of work opportunities, like when was your last job, how long ago was it, how many days did it last. But when we asked about people over the last year what their earnings were and their days worked, we actually saw that the lesbians and gay men worked more days than the heterosexual people did, but they actually earned a little bit less total over the year from acting. And when we divided those two to get the average daily rate, we saw that you know, that just really pushed down the average rate for the LGBT people. So interestingly, it was really not because they're working fewer days, but because they're working more days.
I've always said I'm working really hard. Now I know why.
That's right.
The other, my next question is a logistical question as well that somebody here in LA asked. It was about the derogatory remarks. So this is from slides 9 and 11. They were wondering if you could clarify derogatory remarks from LGBT or toward LGBT people. Who were they from? Other actors, crew, producers, writers? What's the breakdown? What sort of discrimination? I think that might have felt a little vague to the person who asked the question.
Mm-hmm. Lee, do you have those specific numbers available? I don't have them on hand.
No, in terms of the experiences of discrimination and harassment, we were asking about whether people had been fired from a job, whether they had been cut at some point from the final product, whether there was some specific kind of harassment. We put together all of those different kinds into one general measure because for any one of those other more specific ones, there were very small numbers of people. But when you looked at how many people had experienced at least one of those, it was actually much more common to have experienced one of them. So the report has more details on those specifics, but it does capture a wide variety of types of discrimination and harassment.
And it included things like derogatory names, slurs, things of that nature?
That we actually captured separately, I believe. I don't think that was included in here. The harassment would go beyond that. Okay.
Right.
Adam, do you have any more questions? Because I think we're getting ready to move on. But if you have a few in New York.
Sure. So to that point, I mean, if people want to refer to the study and some of the things that Lee was talking about, on page 29 of the printed study where we talk about, this is in chapter 6, about working as a performer, there is a figure there, 6.4, that talks about this idea of how often people have heard anti-gay comments from crew, producers, and directors, and it breaks it down by, you know, how often have people heard those kinds of things? Has anybody heard those things by LGB or heterosexual? And so it leaves right that it broke it down not only what kinds of things that people have been experiencing directly, but also the kinds of things that people have witnessed or heard, whether or not they've felt those things directly. And the interesting thing, and I think the thing that we were going to have to talk to the industry about is that these aren't things that are happening in isolation. These are things that are being witnessed with the same kind of frequency that they're being experienced. So it's not as if that experience is just being felt by the person, but it's actually being noticed by other people, our members on set when they're working. So that section of working as a performer has a lot of that data in it in greater detail. We don't have any other specific questions to the researchers. Some things have come up during this portion that we're going to end up throwing at our illustrious panel here in a moment. That was an incredible presentation. I want to thank Lee and Jody for being with us tonight for this. And for
thank you.
Dave John. It's many years and an astounding number of hours of work put into this to have this first of its kind study. But now it's time to do what you can to digest that a bit and hear from some of our committee leadership on how some of this data plays out in the day-to-day life as people are actually navigating their careers. I mean, it's one thing to talk about the numbers and the statistics that we have and about advocating for equal access, but it's quite another thing to actually pursue a career in this business and experiencing these things as they exist as part of actual lives. It's a different deal. And so we're going to hear about that from the committee members and staff leadership who have been on the forefront of this study and these issues. So here in New York, let me introduce the folks sitting next to me. At the far end here in New York City is Traci Godfrey, best known for her recurring roles on Law & Order Criminal Intent, As the World Turns, and my personal favorite, Grand Theft Auto. She is, I suppose, not so incidentally being here tonight, but she is the national co-chair of the SAG-AFTRA LGBT Committee. So thank you, Traci, for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Sure. Yeah. And sitting right next to me is Duncan Crabtree-Ireland, our chief operating officer and general counsel here at SAG-AFTRA. He's responsible for facilitating decision-making and accountability across the union staff team, as well as for all legal affairs and strategy. He's also my boss, so everybody be nice. He is a delegate to the International Federation of Actors, or FIA, and the conveyor of its International Working Group on LGBT Equality, Duncan Crabtree Ireland. And since we can hear you already, we're going to go back to Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Assuming that you guys are all ready to go and Gary ready to introduce the folks out there, and then we'll start this conversation.
Great, Adam. We have three panelists here in LA. Jason Stuart is the national co-chair of SAG-AFTRA's LGBT committee. He is an actor, a comedian. Please clap. Go, go, go. He is an actor, a comedian, and can be seen in the recently released feature Love is Strange with John Lithgow and Alfred Molina, as well as Real Bob, It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, Entourage, House, and The Closer. Our next panelist is Dana Kristen Vahle, and Dana is a member of SAG-AFTRA's LGBT committee and a former U.S. Army aviator, a long time, somebody in the audience just went, huh. A longtime SAG-AFTRA member, Dana has worked as a pilot for NBC News and aerial coordinator for film and television productions. Dana. And our last panelist this evening is Parvesh Chhina, is a member of the LGBT committee and made his film debut in 2002 in Barbershop, and since then has worked steadily in over 50 film and television productions. He is also a producer who may perhaps be best known for his role as Gupta on Outsourced. Parvesh. So sort of what we want to do to kick off the conversation is we've drafted a few questions that we're going to start this dialogue off with, and then we're going to open it up to your questions as well. The one thing I'd love to point out is that when we're talking about a lot of these issues, some people's personal anecdotes or stories will feel relatable to everyone. They'll feel very universal. And sometimes someone's will feel very unique and very individual. So the one thing I really want to do is just hold space for the spectrum of those experiences that get shared here today, okay? I think let's start with a question. Most of them are pulled from the study or inspired by the study. And the study found that LGBT respondents were less likely than straight respondents to have an agent, which was something that I found kind of interesting. So I'm wondering maybe, Jason, if you can share a little bit about your particular experience as an LGBT performer in relation to seeking representation, navigating representation over the years, et cetera.
I've had 467 agents. And what's interesting in the last couple years is what I've experienced is that a lot of agents are interested in representing me, and this is just my own experience, but a lot of them, and I will say, you know, then there's the gay thing, and we talk about that for a second, and most of them say, doesn't matter to me at all. And it doesn't to them. And then they spend a year representing you and realize, oh my God, there's so many things that I have to go through if you're a gay person. There's the phrase always, that they say that we're waiting for that special role. Well, I'm waiting for that special check. So there still is that problem. There still is that problem. So I've switched around a bit, and we're seeing how that works.
Let me ask you this to kind of expand on that a little bit. I'm wondering if you've ever experienced when interviewing with agents or for agents. I mean, there's two things. One, they're trying to get you jobs as an artist, right? And they're also trying to make money. It's a business about making money, right? So frequently for me, and I'm wondering if this is true for you at all, when I sit in an agent's office, I sometimes can kind of see, almost in their eyes, how many dollar signs they see above my head, right? How marketable are you, right? How much money can we make together, kind of thing. And sometimes I wonder if being an LGBT performer somehow puts you at a disadvantage in their eyes in relation to how much money they could potentially make or work they could get you.
This is how I've counteracted that. So for me, I've done probably 50 independent films and shorts and web series. I've taken all those clips and I put them into 2-minute clips. So I want them to have the products that they can use to sell me. And I've also, when I turned 40, I started going back to class and studying and changing different things about the way I move for different kinds of characters. You know, Dan was talking about how he just played who he is. Well, if you're lucky enough to get those really big, wonderful gay roles, and I would love them, we'd all love them, but it doesn't always happen that way for all of us, you listening at home and you in New York and here in LA. So sometimes you have to find a way to make yourself sellable, show those people, those casting directors, producers, and directors, writers, that you can play different kinds of roles. So that's what I've done, is I've created a library of different kinds of roles so I can keep on working.
Right, it makes sense. So there is that additional, I mean, and the study kind of reflects it, there is that additional, you have to prove your marketability as opposed to an agent actually can see your potential marketability, right, if you were a heterosexual performer.
Right, but
perceived as one.
I was just talking to an actor, John Lacey, who's we were talking about that same thing, and he was saying, no, I don't have to do that, because he's who he is, you know. But if you come with the baggage of being an openly gay person and having some notoriety from it, then you have to deal with that, and you put it on the table, and you just, you know, you show up, and you put up, and you know, it's like that staring game when you were a kid. Mm. You got to stare them down until they do it.
Mm. Makes sense. Parvesh, do you have any experiences in this area that you want to share?
About where the agent
Your experiences navigating representation and how that plays out or has played out.
Yeah, for me personally, the first thing, you know, it's also being gay as well as ethnic. The first thing that I think that also Dana touched upon is when the first thing that people see when they see me is my ethnicity. Mm-hmm. So for my career, it's almost been sexuality and gender identity is almost secondary to my ethnicity as the first and foremost thing that people identify me as. So, again, that's just been my path. Like, I don't play too many gay characters. And if I do, it's, like, totally separate from my Indian South Asian-ness. Mm-hmm. Like, I've never really played a lot of specifically gay South Asian characters, you know, that, at least on paper. I mean, they're always going to be a gay South Asian when it is me playing it, but... right? But
and left-handed, if you happen to be left-handed.
But don't get that first
and with very nice hair. I have to say, I touched his hair and everything.
Oh, Jason.
Nice.
That was creepy. No, I love you. You just have hair envy. I know.
I do.
So that's the first thing that when an agent or any representation sees me, especially because like South Asians became kind of really like hot. Everyone wanted like their South Asian in the stable. Mm-hmm. So, and then I even couldn't like follow one agent to another place because I think she had Cal Penn already. And then, you know, that's what it was. Like the landscape was in 04, 05. Like, why would I take you? I already have one. Yeah. So now you just literally had to go to where you had go to a place where they didn't have it. And now it's, now even that's antiquated 10 years later. Cause like one of my good friends, Malik Pantroli, who's worked with Dan and is an out, I can say this now, I mean, he's an out South Asian actor. And he's very visible, you know, doing a lot of stuff for HRC, for the White House as well. So we have the same managers. So it can happen. You can have two of the same kind and even two gay South Asian people at the same place. So my path has been very, I've been very blessed in that regard. I think it's even harder, I think, now for a gay white male for representation than it is for anyone of ethnicity.
A gay white male, I was actually just, because you raise an interesting point, right? So there's something about sexual orientation being a non-visible minority, right? That creates an additional layer or additional kind of unspoken challenge occasionally. So you frequently, you know, you were talking about the visual, right? So you're categorized by, let's say, an agent when you're seeking representation based on the visual, but then there is something that is not visual, and then navigating that can sometimes be, can be a challenge.
I've also had, and this is not, you can portray it as a sadness, and I think it's also changing. This is, it's, oh, you know, to quote Dan Savage and Trevor Project, it is always, it's getting better. But I play a lot of asexual, non, you don't ever, and this is true. I know the package that I'm dealt. You know, this nose, this height and everything. I will play a lot of characters where you never will picture them having sex. It's very asexual. This is not like, this is
and
nothing
now
I'm like railing against.
And we all just pictured you having sex.
Great,
right? You said
I'm glad.
That, right?
I'm single
Everyone
now, so
Everyone was using their eyes in the audience. They all went.
Good. Adam straight, though. But, like, he's the one I like.
Yes?
Teasing. But there's that thing where, like, but there's that element of like, I'm not sexualized. You know, this I've got a new show coming on NBC and I'm playing a straight character and it's like the first time where I'm like dealing, the gimmick is me and my coworker, we are exes and we're always together and we're not giving away too much. We'll like hook up and then we'll like be broken up again.
Right.
It's really my first kind of character on TV where I'm like, I have a sexual history with someone.
It makes sense. Being a character actor, sometimes you skirt that whole sexuality, yeah, playing straight, playing gay situation by being a character actor.
It's easier for, and this is just a truth, it's easier for character actors to come out than it is for leading men types. You know, everything that, I think Dan touched on it, Rupert Everett has gotten into some trouble where he's told and advised actors, especially I think the leading men, the you know, the pretty ones, stay in if you want to work. And, you know, I think that wall is eroding. Mm-hmm. I definitely think it is.
Oh, I definitely think it's changing. It really is. I think because there are three types of people. There are the people that love us, the people that hate us, and the people that don't care. And I would like to push the idea of let's go to the people that love us, the people that don't care, and let's not keep concentrating on the people that hate us all the time. Yeah. You know, I think that's really important.
I think our next question.
Thank you, New York.
From New York. Yay, New York.
LA is way too cool to clap that many times.
We're very laid back here. There's nothing raucous over here. I hear the noise in New York.
They're just clapping to keep warm.
Hang on.
That's cold.
Actually, Traci, this next question, if we can, we'll go to you in New York, if that's okay.
Sure.
Great. 43% of people who responded to the survey agreed that casting directors choose the best actor for the job, regardless of their sexual orientation or gender identity. However, in the study, it also found that 31% of all people who responded indicated that they think casting directors are biased against LGBT performers. Can you talk to us about auditioning casting directors, what that has been like for you?
Well, I will say, you know, I've been doing this long enough to now come full circle and learn from my partner and I. Between the two of us have three beautiful children, and they don't see color, they don't see sexuality, they live in this amazing world where we all should live. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, I started, you know, when I started in New York, I came to New York in 1984. I was two. And thanks, Gare.
And I was going to be born in 15 years.
That's, thank you very much. I can't wait to come and arm wrestle you, baby.
I wasn't even born. But anyway, so.
Oh, Jason, we all know. At any rate, I have found that I have, in the hierarchy of what we discussed earlier, yes, indeed, it is true that I have been known to be very careful throughout the years of who I came out to or who I did not come out to. And in fact, I was more specific about male and female. Sometimes not even, it wasn't necessarily, oh, I didn't come out to the males because they were flirting with me, or I didn't come out to the females because it was a very specific personality type that I had to kind of navigate on top of navigating my work. And just going in as a pure artist and just going in as we all try to do and go in and do your best work possible. On top of that, there was this little ice cream cone of, oh, gosh, okay, wait a minute, hold on. What if they find out I'm gay and they're going to cast me as the senator's wife? Oops, you know, maybe that won't happen. I mean, I've lost roles for auditioning for gay roles because I wasn't gay enough looking, which I found odd, which was discriminatory, frankly. You know, so, yeah, I still think about it, even at my, you know, ripe old age of 32. Ba-dum-bum. At any rate, so, yeah, it always happens, but it's still out there. It's not my imagination. It's unfortunate. What I love, again, I'll go back to my children with Deborah. These kids, they are from everywhere, and they're gorgeous, and they don't see color or sexuality. In fact, I won't, say which one it was, but the other day, one of them said, I'm not sure what I'm going to be, and she didn't, oops, I just gave it away. She didn't mean, I don't know if I want to be an actress or a physician or a veterinarian or this or that. She meant, I don't know if I'm going to be gay or straight, and that's none of your business right now, and frankly, it's not. And I love that. I would have never been able to do that at that age. Yeah. I would have never been able to consider that. At all. I still, to this day, am not out to, I mean, I'm out to my agents, but that took a long time. And I was concerned that it was going to be an issue. Whether subliminally or not, and I can't tell you what someone else's back of the brain or front or whatever they're thinking, you know, it may be, oh, God, Traci Godfrey might be great for this. Oh, wait, she's gay. You know what? Maybe she's, maybe Joan would be better. Who knows? Yeah. It happens.
Absolutely.
You know, so totally, that's, you know.
Totally appreciate your honesty and sharing there. The good news is that your children and that generation will be future agents and casting directors and producers.
But I'll be too old to get a job then.
You're only 32. What are you worried about?
You got plenty of time. You have plenty of time. I think we're going to move on to the next question. I'm wondering if you guys could talk to us a little bit about the experiences on set. They were talking a little bit in the study about discrimination. And I kind of earmarked this because more than a quarter of heterosexual respondents, more than a quarter, and more than half of lesbian and gay respondents reported hearing anti-gay comments from crew, directors, and producers. That's pretty high, right? I'm wondering, Parvesh, if you could speak to that a little bit. Any experience, thoughts?
Personally for me, I'm the one who's usually being racist and discriminating on sets. I've not. In my life, I've never seen it. And if it is, it's coming from like a friend of mine who were just teasing each other. That's also my humor and my comedy where I do. When I was sitting there listening to the ladies present the panel, when I heard that almost like half have been have experienced it, I was shocked. And I just would just, even, you know, being a SAG-AFTRA rep, I just would want to think that say something. You know, that's that element of, like, if I ever heard, even, like, you know, like, the Teamsters or whoever, like, you're going to make some callous joke or what, and even something that they don't know, I just would imagine, you know, how you always imagine what you're going to say to them. So I'm just sitting there thinking of, like, hey, guy, it's not cool, or please don't, or I'm gay, or this and that. I have never heard it, not directed at me, nor anyone else.
Correct. I think you're actually starting to highlight something, too. I just remember, and I'm not gonna date myself either, but back in my first job, I remember going to my first gig and being in, like, the wardrobe department, and I was like, beep, 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 beep. And then I went to hair and makeup, and I was like, beep, 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 beep. And then I went to set, and I was like, oh, different environment.
Yeah.
And I sort of could feel myself contract a little bit. Wow, a lot of people just nodded here in LA. I wish you kind of could have all seen that. But what happened was I just sort of became a little bit of a lesser version of myself.
Yep.
Again, people are nodding. So yeah. Just the fact that that exists, whether we're actually hearing those anti-gay comments or not, there is a shift within the working day in relation to how sometimes I think we function. And I think there's something there to really be explored. Dana, do you have something that you want to...
Well, my experience was, I had worked on NCIS since its beginning and JAG before that, and I started transitioning after I worked for them, as I kind of dropped out of everything for a while, and they called with a specific job for me to do, and explained to the stunt coordinator, who's been a friend of mine for a long time, that all of this was going on, and he's like, yeah, but are you available Monday or not? So it's like, so yes, they were great. The day we did a scout, then the day of the shoot, the effects coordinator, who I've known for years and go through all of those shows, came up, grabbed my hand to shake it, and then pulled me to him and gave me a hug. Producer shows up, same thing, puts his arm around me, walks me around the set and says, just remember, this is your show. So big plug for NCIS. They're cool about it.
See? Which is really great. I think the more we embrace those positive moments and use them as kind of role models, then the more we shift the statistic that we were talking about. Because, I mean, it's not going to really do us any good to harp on that statistic, right? That many people experience kind of discrimination in the workplace. But the more we highlight the positives, both of your experiences, the more we can kind of model behavior in the work environment. I think that's kind of really important. I'm getting, Adam, a little bit that we should kind of begin to move on. Do you have questions in New York for our panelists?
Not specifically to the presentation that the researchers gave, so I think that we can move on. I think that we can maybe close this out with, I can talk to you maybe a little about some of the anecdotes that we've gotten and maybe some themes that we've been hearing. We've heard it from Dan talking about how essential, I think he used the word essential, it was for him and his life to come out. We've also heard sort of about the tension between what it is to be in this business, which means it's not about who you are, it's what you can play. But more often than not, what you bring to the table visibly, or your affectation, or the way that you speak, or the way that you walk, or you don't walk, or talk, or don't talk, influences the way someone sees you. So it's not as cut and dried as, well, that's not who I am, this is what I can play, because those things are all part and parcel of who you are as a performer and what you bring to the table. And depending on who's making those decisions or influencing those decisions, it depends on how much somebody may consider those things. One of the anecdotes that was related was somebody said that, you know, when they were first starting out and they were working in the soaps in the 80s, there was an older actor who said, who was a Broadway a person and did a ton of TV and sort of a father figure, a patriarch in the industry, and said, hey, look, if you want to get cast and stuff and you want to be looked at as sort of neutral, you want to be looked at as open for all roles, wear a wedding. Just do that and it'll kind of ease your way into whatever it is you want to do. And then anybody, you're a blank slate, potentially. Now, this is the 80s. Traci talked about her experience coming up here in New York in particular. We also got a question off of Twitter, which I think, you know, I'm not going to pose this to anybody, but it kind of brings us from the 80s to here as we go into the next portion of this and what we're going to do with this study moving forward. But it is, you know, given the rapid rate of change and the widespread acceptance in LGBT rights across this country, is a fall 2012 study already dated? In some ways, I think that this is a moving target. I think that we all believe and hope that we're experiencing things different, whether it's newer generations, younger generations, more tolerance and acceptance. But I suppose the takeaway there is, you know, thankfully, for a variety of reasons, but thankfully it's not the 80s anymore. You know, we'll bring the fashion back and leave the rest behind. And or not. But I think it tells us about how quickly all of this is moving and why it's important for us to capitalize on this tool that we have now to talk about what is it that we're going to do. Now that we know these things, what are we going to do with it? We're going to take you through what we've done till right now to get to this place, what we plan to do, and we want to hear from you in the rooms and via Twitter again as we go through this, because we can only feel so secure about what it is we're going to do with this study so long as we know what it is that you believe that we should be doing. So if we can ask the folks in New York, we'll go to the first slide of this presentation. We'll talk to you about what we've done to get us to here. And it looks like we're there. The what we've done so far, which is the next slide. As President Howard had mentioned, and we'll go to the next slide. Are we on the next slide on the live stream? No, close. We're getting there. So this is the second slide. It talks about what we've done so far. As President Howard mentioned last September, when this study was first publicly released at a press conference as part of our 2013 and our inaugural SAG-AFTRA convention, the entire convention, the body of this institution that makes the decisions, decided that they wanted to endorse this in a unanimous resolution to support the work that this committee is going to do based on these findings. Throughout this time, the LGBT committee has maintained that it is here as a resource for people who are looking for support as they make these important decisions about how to navigate their personal and professional lives. And they're always available to talk to anybody about what it is that they're going through. And so you can find them by dialing 323-549-6644. You can find them at diversity@sagaftra.org. You send it to us, you send it to the union, it gets to the people on this committee, it gets to your allies so that they can perhaps offer any assistance that they might as you're navigating your way through this. And then we're at today. We wanted to make sure that we had as much member input as possible, which is why we set up this live stream and set up this environment so that people can actually let the committee know and let us know, are we on the right track? What is it that we need to be taking into these rooms that we're going to be talking about here in a second, so that we can represent you appropriately? As we go to the second slide, Duncan's going to take us through the next year of this plan so you get a sense of exactly what we plan to do with it and can give us feedback on that. Duncan?
Thanks, Adam. Before we go to the next slide, I do want to say, back on that first bullet on the slide that you just talked about, which was the convention, I know because I can see here in the room in New York, there were a couple of convention delegates who are here with us today who were there when that resolution was adopted. And I'll bet, although I can't see the room in Los Angeles, so I can't verify this, I'm sure there's probably at least a few people in that room who were there as convention delegates, along with some of us and the staff who were there. And as someone who's been involved with this committee since its founding about 8 years ago, I can tell you this union has already come a long way. And there's people involved in the committee who know about this, who know about some of the challenges, even advocating within the union for access and for equal treatment for LGBT people. I can't tell you how heartwarming it was, and there's some others in this room who can as well tell you how heartwarming it was to see the entire set of convention delegates, over 400 of your fellow members who've been elected to be there at that convention, not just vote unanimously to adopt the resolution supporting this committee's activities, but to stand up from their seats and to do that by acclamation, and to have that motion, that convention resolution proposed, not just by one, not by two, but by all 10 of the national officers of this union proposed that resolution. It was a very meaningful moment. And I think that it really speaks volumes to how far we've come within the union, which is crucially important because how we move forward, we have to be moving from a strong base. And that base is the union, and it's the solidarity that all of our members have for each other and that the union provides. And so I just wanted to make sure that the moment didn't pass without us acknowledging that and the amazing work that your elected leaders and your elected delegates did to, you know, cause that to happen. Talking about where we go, I get the privilege of talking a little bit about our short-term goals over the next 12 months and how we might take some of this information and use it to help create change for the members of this union. First of all, organizational partnerships are a crucial part of what we're going to be doing and something that we can do immediately, not something that takes a long buildup to achieve. We already have strong relationships with lots of organizations that I'm sure everyone in this meeting is familiar with, including organizations like GLAAD, organizations like HRC, organizations like a whole host of LGBT film festivals around the country, especially including NewFest here in New York and OutFest in Los Angeles, and including the LGBT affinity groups at our major employers, such as the studios and networks, for example. So we intend to reach out to all of those groups to share the information that's contained in this study, because one of the crucial things that this study documents, one of the things we've heard for the last 8 years as we've tried to move forward in these areas is, how do we really know these problems exist? Because you hear one person say one thing, another person say another thing. What's really happening out there? And now, for the first time, because this information didn't exist anywhere, the first time, thanks to Williams, thanks to Lee and Jody, thanks to all the members who participated in this project, we actually have something that we can present that says this is a real problem and we need you to work on real solutions. So our start for that is organizational partnerships. One other organizational partnership I haven't specifically mentioned yet, but is our sister unions. And not only our sister unions here in the US that you might be immediately thinking of, like Actors Equity, DGA, WGA, et cetera, but our sister unions, our sister actors unions around the world. And so we, as SAG-AFTRA, are part of an international organization called the International Federation of Actors. And one of there are only two actors' unions in the world who had ever done any kind of survey like this up until now. One of them is Equity UK, the British Actors' Union, and the other is SAG-AFTRA. And I'm really happy to tell you that the actions by us and by Equity have inspired the FIA International Working Group on LGBT Equality to prepare a draft survey to be distributed to all of the actors' unions around the world to be distributed to their members to gather this information, not just for the UK and the US, as has already been done, but to start gathering that information in other countries and other languages so that we can advance this cause. And moving these issues forward on the international level is even slower than moving them forward in the US for a lot of reasons. I'm sure everyone here is familiar with the fact that in some parts of the world, there's a lot of work to be done. Some parts of the world, you know, they're not arguing over same-sex marriage. They're arguing over should gays be put in prison and executed. So we obviously have a long way to go around the world. But as much, you know, we care equally about our actor brethren around the world as we do for our actor brethren here. And so I think it's of huge importance that starting to gather this information is going to happen on a worldwide basis. And in fact, later this month, at the upcoming meeting of the Executive Committee of FIA, they're going to be reviewing the draft survey, and I expect approving a plan to distribute that survey to affiliate member unions around the world. That's more than 60 affiliate unions, 60 different countries around the world. So we'll be very much looking forward to seeing the progress that we can make by that type of collaboration and partnership. Another thing that we plan to do in the short term over the next 12 months is our educational summit and summit series for members. Because again, if we don't have a strong foundation, we have nowhere to go. So we need our own members to understand what's in the material that we have, not just our LGBT members and not just our actor performer members, but SAG-AFTRA as a merged union now, we have members across the sound recordings industry. We have members who are professional journalists and broadcasters and entertainment broadcasters. And we need all of our membership to understand the implications of the information that we've put together. And that's something that we're committed to doing over the next 12 months. And that will provide a lot of opportunities for us to expand our outreach and to bring in allies from our own membership to help make the case for the change that we want to see. And finally, We are in the process of putting together a speakers bureau so that we can take advantage of one of our greatest assets. I mean, nobody knows better than us how attracted people are to shiny objects. And who has more shiny objects than SAG-AFTRA in terms of our amazing membership? Whether it's Dan Bucatinsky or any of you who are here in the room in New York or Los Angeles or on the live stream, this is our opportunity to play to our strength and to make sure that we are speaking out and to make sure that we are making our members available to help create that change. If we won't speak out, if we won't talk to people about it, it'll be very hard to convince them that change needs to happen. So we're very excited about putting that together, and that's another project that we'll have rolling in the next 12 months. So I think that that's the end of this slide, and it's my chance to both pass the microphone along virtually to Jason back in Los Angeles, and just to take one more moment while I have the floor to say that everyone here should know, while you've had amazing leadership in this committee over the last 8 years, I'm sitting next to one of those amazing leaders now, Traci, Godfrey. I see others of them out in the room here, and I know they're in the room in Los Angeles. As the person who initially received one of Jason's letters that he sent to the president of then SAG, asking for the creation of this committee, you should know that, in my opinion, this committee would not exist if Jason Stuart hadn't done that. He stood up and demanded the creation of this. That applause is well deserved, Jason, and I just want to say, you know, there's nothing I'm sure that makes Jason prouder. It certainly makes me proud to see what this committee has become. There might be some of you in LA or here in New York who were there for our very first caucus that we had 8 years ago when we were wondering, was anyone going to even show up? And in fact, a lot of people showed up. And that was the kickoff for the work that's been done up to now. And so anyway, Jason, I just wanted to say thank you for your work that caused all of this to be set in motion.
Oi. Hold on. thanks for answering my letter. I kept sending it. And that's what a gay Jew has to do in this biz to get something to move. And I also want to thank Duncan, because Duncan, if it wasn't for him, this is a gay man who's married to a man, he's got kids, and he's an activist, and he's been such a mentor to me. And if you need a mentor, get one. It's important to have that in your life. And also to thank Adam and Ellen. They work so hard, and they always take my calls. And no matter if we get along, whether we agree on stuff or not agree on stuff, things get done. They tell me honestly. I tell them honestly. And that's something that you all can do. Is you can, don't call them because you'll make them nuts. But email them. Ellen is on top of it. Adam is on top of it. They have been so supportive to this committee. And we had a casting summit or a casting workshop or whatever you want to call it. We keep changing the name. I don't understand what it all means. But we had a casting workshop, and there was a casting director here. And he said, someone had asked him for a question from the audience. They asked him, they said, would you think of openly gay people to play doctors, lawyers, restaurant managers, clerks, the roles that I play most of the time? Would you think of that, you know, of us once in a while, so we could play those roles in the same way? And this was a gay man who was a casting director. He said, I just don't think about it. I'm rushing around so much, but now I will. And that really made me think about that we have to change one person at a time. It's not, you know, we can do this and we big things and have big celebrities come and talk, but it's really important to do it one at a time. Being out, when you are out, you're not just out for me, I'm out for you, we're out for all of us. I've made tremendous friends here doing this and supportive. Dana called me on the phone when she had, I guess we were transitioning and she had a knee surgery, and she called me on the phone. And she called Ellen. And then Ellen called me and said, hey, there's this gal, Dana, would you talk to her? I said, sure. She said, I'm a stunt person. This is what I'm going through. This is what's happening. We talked. We had lunch. She came to my show. I went to an awards banquet with the stunt people. It was just crazy. And we learned each other's lives. And now she's on the committee representing transgender stunt people. Who knew, right?
Yeah.
you know, people are busy. You know, Ellen is busy. Adam is busy. They're the heads of their departments here on both coasts. It's not easy for them to take every single call, but they do, and they return things, and we're on it. And I just want you to all know that we are here for you. You know, you go to my website, jasonstuart.com. You have a question, you email me. I will get back to you. I will try my best to let you know if it's something that we can do to support you to being who you are. Thank you all really much.
Oh, I was going to say, Jason, your task is to read slide number 3.
So that is the future. That we were thinking about putting together a handbook. We don't know if that's going to be the best thing. We're thinking about that. What we want to do is do it one person at a time. We want to start talking to studio executives. We want to start talking to producers, casting directors, which we've already done. We have a great relationship with the gay group at the Writers Guild. We're involved with them. The directors, that's something new. Agents, that's still something new that we have to attack. So we are going to create small round tables with them. That's my idea, is us going in and talking to people face to face in an intimate way so they can see who we are, so we can make changes to them and let them know what we're thinking, what we're feeling. And that's our next process, part of it. And I look forward to all of your ideas and everybody here being who they are and feeling comfortable and us all working. And my big thing is to create opportunities for everyone. More opportunities. That's what my goal is. Thank you.
So one of the first questions that we have from someone here in the room is all about creating opportunities. I'm kind of paraphrasing a little bit. But how will that actually be executed? Won't it take more than handing out literature or this study to change people's behavior in the entertainment business?
Well, that's why I just said what I just said, is that I think we have to start talking to people. You know, Parvesh is on a show. He's going to have the opportunity to speak with people about, hey, maybe there's a friend that I can hire, you know, to help out a friend. You know, comedians do it all the time. You know, someone's funny, they call on the phone and say he's funny. Somebody's openly gay in their committee, he thinks about it, he calls somebody. And that's how it happens, and starting to have these conversations with the power brokers in our business and letting them know that we're capable of playing generic roles as well as others.
I also think that there are so many gay people working in casting and producers, you know, I think I always, whenever I, you know, we actors, whenever we start like kind of complaining and griping and thinking about like the hardships in our business, I think we always have to partner with a writer. I think there's an element of like, it's their words. And I think this also comes to my ex as a writer, so I have him in my brain where it's you want to change something, start writing your own stuff as well as working with a writer because as like the generation keeps going up and now they're, you know, it used to just be like that one diversity hire in a writing room and, you know, for staff writers. And now they're like 4 or 5, you know, my friend Christelle has got a show and on ABC and she's Latina and they're like 6 Latina people on the staff, which is kind of unheard of. Like, you know, like you'd have like a black show and there'd be maybe one black writer on it, which was not representative. Even SNL has this problem right now where, you know, I think that they're maybe back up to 1 or 2 black writers again after having a dearth of none. So if you want sometimes yourself to be represented in film and TV, we have to also make sure that we're nurturing. I love the fact that we'll be working with the DGA and WGA. I think that that's important too. If we don't have that support and helping shoot someone's web series, you know, who might be tomorrow's co-executive producer, you know, on an hour long on NBC, that's where you want to help there too.
So we're talking about two approaches, actually. We're talking about creating our own work, right, from the ground up, and then we're talking about from the top down. We're talking about taking the content of the study and sitting down and having conversations with literature and dialogue around some of the challenges, right? So you're talking about meeting with networks and studio executives and saying these are the findings and this is the conversation we'd like to have, as well as the other end, which is creating work from the ground up. Does anybody in New York have anything they want to add to that? I see Duncan, I think, might want to add.
Yeah, no, thanks, Gary. I just wanted to point out, I mean, I think that the value, I think we all agree the study won't create change by itself. But the value of the study and the reason why we we put in the resources to do this study is because there was sort of a mantra coming back at us as we started having these conversations that Jason referenced earlier, which was, is this really a problem? You know, is this just the perception of the media? Is this just a perception? And in fact, on Twitter, there's a person who just commented that, in fact, you know, Hollywood is far more accepting and inclusive than media and the panelist study would have people believe. And that's exactly why we had to have the study. You know, now you can, obviously everyone's free to agree or disagree with the results of the study, but the whole point of the study was, let's not have a debate about whether Hollywood is or isn't accepting of LGBT people or whether discrimination is or isn't happening. Let's find out. Let's ask the people who are actually experiencing it. And, you know, having 6,000 responses to it, frankly, having a whole bunch of non-LGBT people saying, yes, I've witnessed it myself, tells us it is happening. So people can say whatever they want, but that's the reason why we have the study. So when we go out and have those conversations, and frankly, when all of you go out and have those conversations in those one-on-ones like Jason was describing, now you've got something to back you up that says, yes, this is a real problem, and that's why you should pay attention to it.
And I would like to add, Gary, as well, I think it's obviously the importance of all the work that has been done on this is so that we do have a tool in our back pocket in order to go out, not just to those communities, but I would say that we need to go to the advertising communities, the advertising world, not just the TV producers or the writers or the, you know, I'm a writer as well. I have a play that's, you know, got LGBT themes. I get that. But let's go out to the people who are, you know, casting commercials and writing commercials and adding diversity and LGBT themes to those. That's what's hitting the main target. Those little bites, the 15 and 30 second and 1 minute spots, are hitting us harder than we think. And when we start adding LGBT themes, not necessarily themes, but just normalcy to that kind of advertising, then it's going to be a whole lot easier to get into the mainstream of film and television, etc. I think that now that, you know, we have this fabulous tool, it's a reality. We didn't imagine it. It's been done thanks to all the hard work of everybody here. Now we've got something to bring into those rooms and to say, hey, here's what's going on, advertising people. Hey, you know, it used to be Madison Avenue, but now it's not. But, you know, here we are. Here's the booklet. Read it.
Yeah, on that note, Tracy, I'm getting more than one question pertaining to the same subject, and it's I'm going to morph three of them. But it's, how can we ask for this form of equality and not be asking for special treatment? Go ahead, Jason.
May I just briefly say,
yeah,
we're not asking for special treatment.
Yes.
We're asking.
Remember, I didn't ask the question. I'm just sharing.
No. No, we'll talk later, Gary. Okay.
I'm going to get beaten up. But continue.
All right,
Jason,
go ahead.
Go.
I mean, Janice, who's one of our transgender members on, said we were having a meeting, and she says, "I want special treatment. I've been waiting a long time." You know, in line. And I thought to myself, when she said that, I laughed, and I looked at Ellen, and I looked at, you know, Gary in the room, I laughed, and I thought to myself, God, you know, what she's saying, really, she's making a joke, but what she's saying is we want to have a level playing field. You know, we want to be able to have the same opportunities as our straight counterparts. We're really far from where it was when I was a kid. I mean, man, I used to walk into a room, I could feel the door shut right in front of my face. I could feel that as a kid, and it certainly affected me in my confidence, in my self-esteem, and in my life as an adult. And to this day, there are still moments that's a first thought. But I have to let that go out of my head and know that I got to stand up for myself, I got to stand up for other people on this committee and all of you who have come. And I do believe that if we keep doing that, if we keep, the more people that are out, the less that'll be a problem, and it won't be... We won't have the idea that it matters. to people.
Jason, I want to broaden that thought because what you're just saying is actually something that came up to me. And someone in the room here in LA said, being a gay performer in Hollywood and Hollywood's general response to that has at times affected my self-confidence. Yes, it's getting better, but it also affects my sense of self-worth and motivation to succeed. Do any of yourselves find feeling similarly? And if so, what do you do about it?
Every Thursday. I mean, there's a good friend of mine here. You find someone to talk to. I'm really serious. Find someone to talk to. Therapy. You know, that's being who you are and being the best you is important to doing your best work as an artist. To being is open, so when you're on that set, you can be who you are, and you can be receptive to playing the character the best way you can.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense.
It's all part of our lives.
Yeah, we can even go back to Dan's speech, right? He was talking about wearing a mask, which prevented him from being really, everyone's nodding, so they got that moment, right? So that thing about being your authentic self means that you are your unique being, right? So if you create yourself as a unique person in this business, in the world, you are irreplaceable. Right? Because if they want a you, then they come to you. So there is some real strength in being authentically yourself.
We've talked about this. There's something about confidence that is so invigorating. And I'd like to find the store that has it because I would buy a lot of it. You know, but that's what it really is. I look at Parvesh. I haven't known him, but you have such an incredible amount of confidence. It's so appealing to me. It really is. He just stands up on who you are. And
Thank you.
You really do from the moment I've met him. And I watch people that have that all the time. And I try to mimic it. And, you know, just pretend until you do.
Well, some of it is also that own self of ego. And self-grandizing. I mean, grandizing. Did I say that word right?
It's correct.
Where, like, I just think I'm awesome. So I mean, there's that element of, like, yeah, you do have your moments of weakness and, like, shit, you didn't get the audition or anything. But ask any minority, anyone with any disability, we have to always remember, like, you know, let alone, obviously, this LGBTQIA group.
LMNOP.
But anyone who's had to suffer through that, like, you have to almost kind of, it's so cliche, but you have to almost be kind of stronger and better so they can't give you a reason not to, or be the best of whatever that is. If I'm going to be the best, like, South Asian gay actor, then I need to be better than the other straight ones or non-South Asians coming in for that same role.
I'm going to refer to the study, because in the study, there's actually a section about training. And there is something that actually alludes to
this
fact that
great.
I thought this was brilliant, that LGBT performers are more equipped and more and have had more training and have studied their craft more. And I think it directly relates to that whole philosophy of I'm LGBT, I have to be better. So there are positive outcomes of, you know, in relation to that as well. And the study actually earmarks it.
I think earlier with the special treatment and equality thing, there's that thing of any actor, we have to be our most authentic self, because I'm not going in for Romeo. You know, like, I know that about myself. I wouldn't cast myself as Romeo. I want to be the best Benvolio, you know, the best friend, or maybe Mercutio, but probably not. But, like, there's that element of, like, you know what you are, and then know you're going to be the best. There's that, I mean, if you're a 4'2" performer, you're probably not going to be, you know, the tall, you're not going to be cast as the tall model.
Yes, you know, I will.
Oh, girl. But there's that thing of, like, there's that element of, like, how much do we say that they didn't cast me, I can do anything, when we know we can't, but we can still be the best at what we can do.
So true. Adam, I'm getting that we have about 5 minutes left. Do you have things in New York or questions in New York or things that you want to share?
Oh, so many things, Gary, that have come in via Twitter and here in the room. A lot of them have to do with this idea of what is it that we can do to actually convince people to act differently, to hire differently, to write differently, to create stories with characters that embody the diversity that we've been talking about. I will say this, and I'll open it up. Parvesh spoke to it earlier as to sort of what it is that he's doing to take the power back and to start telling those stories that he feels are important. If other people aren't telling, go tell them yourselves. You know, I think it's something that we use as a bit of a mantra. You know, we talked about before, it's not who you are, it's what you can play. So bring everything that you can play to the table, and it's somebody else's problem if they don't understand that that's what the criteria is. But if you see something, say something. You got to let the union know, you got to talk to your peers, you got to kind of
make sure that you're not suffering this alone. But I also think that it makes sense to make stuff, make it all the time, and make good stuff. Mm-hmm. Because the idea that we can shine a light on the people who are doing this well, I think is the best advertisement you could possibly have. Nothing says what's possible than good work more than any of that. So I think that make stuff, make it all the time, make good stuff as best you can, and there are no barriers to entry to do that anymore.
And support it,
that,
too, because we have...
Yeah, I think that, you know, if Traci or any other panelists want to talk about what maybe for themselves has been effective, mm-hmm. have you been in an opportunity where you've had a chance to change somebody's mind or make them think differently about what it is that they were doing after you left the room than perhaps when you entered it?
I can speak to that, Adam. I would like to say also, going back to... I think that there's another universe somewhere that's looking at us and going, what? You got to be kidding. They care about the color of your skin. They care about who you sleep with. They care about, it's like, it's, you know, beyond me. And I hope that someday we, you know, I aspire to that. But we might evolve. I'm hoping that we do. I have a play and I wasn't out to some of the people who read the play. It's got LGBT. It's called Sweet Texas Reckoning. It's about a Southern Baptist woman. No, it's not my mom. Who is from UCLA, Texas. No, it's not my mom. She has to deal with her middle-aged daughter coming home with her African-American choreographer dancer. Partner, they've gotten married, and it's a head spin for this woman. And some of the people who read the play, actually one of my producers was like, are you gay? And I was like, yeah. So it was an eye opener. I mean, they thank God it's a good play, and they liked that very much. But my hope is that this will, you know, kind of do its little part in turning some heads as well. But yeah, I think that it would be a great thing to aspire to, you know, those people in that other universe looking down saying, what are you thinking? That would be great.
May I?
Yeah, Adam, I think I'm getting where you have like 2 minutes left. I'm sorry, I don't mean to cut you off. Is that true?
No, Parvesh, yeah, if you want to share something quickly that might be beneficial to other people, please go ahead. We can wrap it up very quickly after
sure.
your comment.
On the ethnic side, I think it's important to, especially with the fan base from Outsource, was mainly South Asian, I would always be very clear, like, oh, no, this is my partner, you know, just because, like, you can't, my community can be very close-minded about that. Mm-hmm. So that was always that opportunity. And then specifically in our, in the professional world, I think that the opportunity is not even at the casting director. I think it's at the producer level when you get to be with the writers and directors in the room. That's the best moment where you can dialogue. Like, I don't think he needs to be this fabulous. He can be this... kind of,
it's real.
He can be like the yes. dowdy gay, you know, he can be this. And that's where you can ask, like, well, what level of education? Because would he have this kind of Indian accent, or would he be more British educated? That's that dialogue where you can have to be like, and if you want it still flaming and fabulous, then maybe I'm not the right guy for it. But writers, again, I come
but
back.
But you are 6 foot two.
When I stand up.
I'll say one little something, too, which is yeah. the first person I told that I was going to transition within the business was a stunt woman, and she told me, you'll never work again. So we're proving that wrong. So.
Yeah. Every day. Every day proving that wrong. Thank you. Well, I can't think of a better note for us to close on. This is not the end. This is the beginning of this. I just want to make sure that before people walk out and sign off, I express my deep thanks to Jody and Lee and everybody at the Williams Institute. Yes, please clap. The fantastic folks at the SAG Foundation. The SAG Foundation made all of this technology possible and is making it. Thank you. Our national president, Mr. Ken Howard, and our special guest, Dan Bucatinsky, for sharing their time. The man behind the plan, Mr. Duncan Crabtree-Ireland.
the whole EEO and diversity team, Ellen, Sylvia, Donna, and Becky, none of this would have been possible without them. Jason, Traci, Dana, Parvesh, all the committee members in the room and both coasts, online, everybody around the country, this is because of you. It's been a long time coming. My partner in crime out in LA, Gary Riotto, he's gunning for my job. I can see it now. You're very good at this, sir. For everybody else, this is going to be a little cheesy. Stay loud. Stay proud. Stay involved. Thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you, everyone.